Thank you all for coming. I want to thank Ryan over here for putting out snacks for us, setting this room up, giving us the opportunity to talk, have everybody learn a little bit about the project.
We have magnets for the library that you guys can take. And then we have a coffee machine in the front too, so if anybody wants to take a break and grab coffee or tea, you can feel free to do that. It's free.
Hopefully I'm not so boring you need coffee. But I might be. Yes.
I have a question before you start. Is this the presentation you're going to do next Tuesday, or will it be different?
I'm assuming we'll end up modifying it after tonight.
Okay.
So anyway, thank you very much for all coming. I appreciate it. We're trying to get good words out, get questions answered prior to town meeting. Go ahead. And usually I have control of the computer, but since I'm up here, I don't. So forgive me if I'm like, oh, Claire. So she's fixing it for us. So what is Main Street Project? This is the key to the whole thing. A lot of people don't even know about it. This is about pavement and infrastructure on Main Street, and also some safety issues that we're trying to fix as part of this project. When we go through the thing at the end, if you have any questions, and there's also pamphlets and stuff up here, grab them. But it'll give you some information about if you forget anything. Go ahead, Claire. So our pavement issues. Anybody who's driven Main Street knows that we have horrible pavement issues. The pavement looks really bad, and if you ask John Wilson, he'll tell you it looks like it's been mortared. So we have a really bad subsurface there. The road's at failure. It was never properly constructed. The town back in like the 70s and 80s did a lot of work on putting new base in the roads. And so they pulled up sections of road, put in good gravel. Main Street was never done. So that makes a significant difference in what we have under there. This is almost original road. When I look through what we've done over the years on that, we've oiled the road, which everybody knows that was really popular up until like mid-70s. Then we started using a cold mix that we put on, and that's all that's on there. Then, you know, there's some overlays, and of course we've tried to patch it up. Good. So with the poor subsurface, to properly repair that, we need to fix the subsurface. You can't pave over. It's like painting over rotted wood. It doesn't do you any good. So this project talks about taking 20 inches of asphalt, road base and asphalt from the grade that we're going to, because there are some grade changes in the project. But so from the ultimate final surface, 20 inches down, and replacing it with 12 inches of gravel and 8 inches of asphalt. Go ahead, Claire. So the pavement issues. First of all, the existing pavement, I've got bullets. go the other way. Forward. No, yeah. The existing pavement structure consists of sandy materials and asphalt. So you can see that sand is kind of the prevalent silty sand, sandy gravel, gravelly sand. Sandy silt, silty sand, sandy gravel, gravelly sand. That's not ideal for a road base. It wouldn't be good for a foundation for your home either. Sand moves and rolls. If you think about walking on a beach, that's basically sand moves all the time. That's why we sweep it every year. Even with an average of 5 inches of asphalt, which is we go from 1.5 to 8 inches because we've patched it so many times, 5 inches is the average. And the road's still failing, even in all the spots. So the asphalt's not even strong enough to manage this. Go ahead, Claire. So the pavement issues that we have, the base, go again. So as you can see, this road's coming on this, and it deflects, it basically flexes, and the roadway has this deflection in it, and it causes cracks. As a general maintenance, what we do is we'll fill the cracks, and then, go ahead, one more, we'll eventually those kick out, we end up with potholes. Sometimes we'll overlay the potholes, trying to make it look better, and try to seal it up a little better. So we can continue to do that, fill potholes, lay large patches, even overlay it, but it won't last because the base isn't repaired. Okay, Claire. So this is an example of just a spot on the town. So this section, we overlaid it with a layer of asphalt in 2011. No work was done on the base of this, and it's cracked, has multiple potholes filled. In the overlay, which you can see right here, one more click, you can see where that is. And so that's basically what we're facing if we just run an overlay over the existing pavement, or if we just don't fix the base. Go ahead. So back to the existing pavement structure. If we pave over the existing base, cracks will appear within a year, potholes will appear within 5 years, and the road surface will be a higher elevation because you just pave over what's there, which actually affects sidewalks and the driveways on the edges of the road. So you'll see that sometimes, one more, many roads, we actually do this reclaim, which is when we mix the asphalt into the base of the road. We crush it in, we mix it in. And what happens with that is that the surface of the road doesn't get lowered. So if we need any, if we need to do anything to it, we have to grade that off. And you end up grading a lot of the good material that you just made. So in order to not have the road higher, and we have so much asphalt and lousy underneath base, we end up moving a lot of that material off if we were trying to do that to this road. Go ahead. So along Main Street, you see that here you can, it's really obvious. This sidewalk is lower than the crown of the road, which is kind of almost level with the stone wall. So we have to reclaim that. We have to pull that grade down. It's about 6 to 12 inches where we do it throughout the project. And then, you know, as part of the project, in order to keep the stone wall and keep a reveal on it, they do build up the stone wall. This, because the sidewalk still has to come up, basically, you don't lower the, you know, we're not going to lower the road to below the existing sidewalk, and still raise the sidewalk. But as part of this, we generally, when we reclaim, we do a 6-inch reclaim. So we have 5 inches of asphalt in some spots and 8 inches of some. So if we only reclaim 6 inches, you can see that we're only getting 1 inch on average of actual material that's ground up and good and changes the base. And so it's really not an option for this project for the road base. So Main Street, a lot of the quotes you'll hear that were really low, we were looking at doing a reclaim and we thought that would work. It's just not going to work. So it needs to not be done through a reclaim process. So the options that we end up with is full depth reconstruction. This takes the road structure, pulls down the 20 inches, and you can see we pull down 20 from the surface. You end up with, on the average, if you assume that where the surface isn't changed, you get 9 inches of the silty sand subbase. But then we put good gravel in, we put a dense graded crushed stone gravel, and then hot mix asphalt, 8 inches of that. The layers in the base basically are like plywood. It gives strength to it. So as part of this full depth reconstruction, that will repair the roadway base, provides a strong foundation for the road. It is an expensive process, which is why the project is costly, but it's the best construction for this project. Also part of infrastructure issues, we have drainage issues on town. Under DEP, we actually have some new standards that we have to meet for our drainage. We have to treat it before we let it go. So we clearly aren't doing that currently on Main Street. And you can see that we actually have basins up the hill, which should be catching that. We have a lot of problems with our drainage up the hill. And it does. This is actually the outlet for most of that, but some of it doesn't even get into the basins. Without a good base, without good drainage, the base will fail. Without both of those things, the road will fail. Also, that we create puddles, and you guys, everybody knows about sometimes when we have a really good rain. This is actually the pipe inlet that at the corner of St. Mark's Field. And that's what takes all that big section of the intersection and takes it down into that stream down by the golf course. It needs to be treated ahead of time. Everybody's seen the water go up over that stone wall before. It's a huge puddle, and when it ices up, obviously it's a problem, safety problem. So the project addresses other safety issues. One of them, increased pedestrian safety. So that's by putting granite curving in, you actually give a vertical separation between the vehicles and the car, vehicles and the pedestrians, sorry. We also have, we shorten the intersection, so not at the intersection, so don't think that spot, but at the intersections of any of the minor roads that come into Main Street, those are narrowed up, so the crossing is a little shorter. We have a road shoulder that's a buffer, so there's right now we have one. You can see we have a 4-foot buffer here, which the handicap, the wheelchair is in. That's not really where the wheelchair should be. It should be on a sidewalk, but there's the sidewalk on this side of Corderville Road is not very good, and there is none on that side right now. But that shoulder is where it basically gives a buffer so that when you're walking on the sidewalk, you're not concerned about cars in there and their mirrors hitting it back of the head or the front of the head. We're using contrasting colors at sidewalks, so that just draws attention to the sidewalk better. And we install new sidewalks, one down to Woodward on that eastern side, one on the western side of 85 up actually to the end of the library parking lot. Then we also have a road shoulder can be used for the bicycles. And that actually keeps them off the sidewalk unless you're a young child, and then they should be bicycling on the sidewalk. And the vehicular safety, by putting in left turn lanes at each approach to the 85 and 30 intersection, it stops people from trying to scoot the light. Or a lot of times you've all been there. You're taking a left, the guy in front of you is taking a left, and the guy behind you tries to go around you, and the guy in front takes a left. And all of a lot of near misses with that. This stops that. It's left turn lanes that actually are exclusive with the lighting system that we would have. So now we're into what the easements are. This is the vote that's at town meeting on next Tuesday. And if anyone doesn't know, because I've come across this a few times, town meeting, you have to be there to vote. So that's just really important that people know that. A lot of people don't know that. Anyway, so we need to give the selectmen permission to take these easements. So you can see this is like the summary list of them. Six of the permanent easements. So a permanent easement, that's something that we're basically going to pave a piece of your land. So a lot of people say it's really just a taking, and it does seem like it really, basically you can consider it a taking because you really are sharing that land now with the town and all the residents. So currently there's a lot of the ones for these nonprofits, by chance, it ends up being a lot of for the wheelchair ramps. We have to be ADA compliant. You end up with a wheelchair ramp at the intersection. So a lot of the school ones, are faith school handicap ramps or wheelchair ramps. The government, obviously, we have some of those too. Most people concerned with the private residences. There's six. It's only 738 square feet. You got to remember, these are really slivers. But out of those six, four of them actually are already paved on, and we're actually just trying to correct something that we've just paved on them ages ago, and now we're just trying to straighten that out. A lot of people with the businesses, there's eight of them, but I know a lot of people are going to ask about the Stones and Morris's across the street and about parking. And so in order to get parking at those locations, we basically split the difference between, and this was probably around between 2010 and 12 at one point. We had been, so it was before the Main Street Group even started, but we had been working with those businesses and said, well, we had one who said, I want you to take all the land from me. We had one who said, I want you to take all the land from the common. And the Historical Society and Commission really didn't want to take all of it from the common. That is that is protected land. And it's important to the town. It's a historical spot. So what happened is we split the difference, we moved the wall a little bit, and then we actually end up, in order to provide parking for those two businesses, we do end up needing an easement for the sidewalk because the sidewalk's important to keep. The total, again, for these private residences is only 738 square feet. Again, I already said they were currently already accommodated. So two are new because of the project. And one of the permanent utility ones, that's for the drainage system down by Parkville Road. All the other utility easements are either aerial or guy wires. So everyone knows what a guy wire is. It's the wire that comes off the utility pole to hold it straight. Those wires, we need permission. The utility company wants permission to have them on someone's yard. You're able to use that land underneath it. You can plant around it. They don't have any restrictions on what you do with that. You just have to allow that to be there. Then there's also aerial easements, and these are weird and hard to explain to people, so bear with me on it. But you have the wires that go overhead on these utility poles. The utility company wants to have 5 feet behind the wires so that they can go up into the wires, and they can cut branches around them or maintain their wires. Your easement's not actually on your ground. It's above your property in those. So that's what the aerial easement is. So most of the utility easements are aerial. You can do shrubs. You can put your stone walls. You can do anything you want under them. You just need, they basically want permission to go up and trim around those wires. So the cost of the project. And then temporary easements, just real quick. Those come off your property right away. They're just there because we're going to either sit on your property to do some work, and then we're going to want to maintain that. We're going to want to fix the grass that we might have messed up. We might be taking down moving a stone wall a couple feet, or taking it down and then replacing it so we can do some other work. That's all temporary, and there's nothing changes about your property with that. Sorry. So now back to the cost. So the project is currently funded through the Transportation Improvement Program. It's called the TIP. The total project cost is $7.2 million, and that's fully funded through the TIP. The TIP pays for this project. It's not like it comes to us and then we pay it. They pay the project. Southborough is part of the Metropolitan Planning Organization, which are the people who actually decide who gets funded by this program. So that consists of 22 people. A lot of them are local. They're generally some sort of elected official from different towns throughout that MPO area. And then there are a few people from the highway and one person from the MBTA. So everyone says it's the highway's money. It's not the highway. It's federal and state that's allocated specifically for projects that'll be local projects. So engineering costs that we've done so far, we have something called Chapter 90, which is money that when the state basically has this money for each town, it's based on how many miles of road you have. So we get about $450,000 a year on that. We get that money, we tell them this is what we're going to use it for, and they say fine. We spend money and then they reimburse us for it. So right now we've actually spent $750,000 for the engineering costs, and a lot of that has been because we've revisited the project so many times. But that's all been reimbursed, so we don't have any outstanding money right now. The appraisals for the easements, those can all be funded through the Chapter 90, because we do have to appraise the easements, then we have to do a review appraisal, then we have to pay for the easements. So the payment can also come through Chapter 90. And again, that's all reimbursed, and that's all reimbursed. Oh, yeah, we'll go to Woodward now. So. At Woodward, there's a new sidewalk to Woodward, the east side of Cordoville. Then we also have we're also going to improve the sidewalk on the west side of Cordoville, which is also benefits, obviously, the senior center, but it benefits Woodward School. And then we're going to delineate the school zone. We don't have school marking signs out there right now on Main Street for the school zone. And we obviously need to do that. A lot of our paint comes up because the road's in such bad shape. So we want to, once it's paved, we'll actually create the zone for real. So the Historical Commission did have some concerns about the project. A lot of it was around the common. So they had a couple requests. The stone marker at the end of Common Street where you come out from the town hall, which people don't know how to navigate. It's both ways on both sides, if anyone does want to know. They want us to keep that, but just make it a little more delineated. There's a granite railing and posts all around the common, except on the Main Street, but up around the Common Street sides. They want us to replicate those and fix them. They had a ground penetrating radar, which we already did along the stone wall to make sure that there weren't any artifacts, we'll call it there. We have to do another one up in the north end. We have to mark the capstones, put them back in the relative same position. Basically, the wall moves 2 feet. So this front of the wall is actually going to move to the back of the wall. And that's how much that's moving. The watering trough, the block steps, those are both to be in the same relative position. And then they didn't want us to touch the war memorial, which we obviously don't want to touch and we're not going to. And then there's some streets, some cast iron common street signs that they want us to replace back in. Take out and put the same ones back in. So then, just because a lot of people have been trying to figure out what things look like. You like that one? That was kind of, sorry. PowerPoint can be fun. So this is right now, and unfortunately, this isn't exactly 100% accurate, so I'll tell you why. But so this is standing kind of at Middle Road looking out up Main Street. So this is Parkerville right here. And we actually have a green strip, a green grass, so that the anticipated project will have it look like. Right now, we actually have a green strip up to about the driveway to 84 Main, and then the grass strip ends. So that's not 100% accurate. So that sidewalk would actually be back a little bit in order to get some green space. That was something that the Main Street Working Group worked hard to try to find spots where we could put that, so that it wasn't just asphalt edge to edge. It would have that it would have some green space. Sidewalks down at this end are asphalt sidewalks. They do turn to concrete farther up in the project, but down here we kept it a little more rustic looking. So now up at Middle Road, so at this point they'd be concrete sidewalks. This transition's around Fay. So you can see we have the crosswalk, which is just it's just treated to look like brick. We've got the wall moved. You've got heading into the intersection where the three lanes start coming out. So that's our anticipation there. Except for the sidewalk, like this, the road itself is the same width here. You've got parking now. That's the difference there. So we really have a lot of the road width. If you look at the plans up here where I have, you'll see that the road's not really widening. Now you come to the intersection and the next one, I think. Oh, no, at the library. So there's a library. And we're actually tightening up the intersection of Common Street. Right now, this is all paved. And part of the reason for doing this is to create a better mouth on Common Street, so you can't just zoom up the hill at speed. It does, because I know it's going to come up. Yes, people do park there right now in this intersection. There wouldn't be parking anymore because we've added this green space. One thing that we did get a lot of pushback on is people don't like the left-hand turn lanes because they think it's a lot of asphalt. And we worked hard to try to add green space everywhere we could, and so this ends up being actually a fortuitous thing that we have this spot that we could put the green space. It doesn't touch the memorial, but the memorial, there's right now, if you remember, there's like a crimson maple right there. So the road is the crimson maple doesn't go. The road's to the east of that. Then we have, this is where Marty was going to start. So just quick, this is Southville and 85 is in the purple color, and this blue color is Main Street and 85. So as you look at that, I was trying to give examples of an intersection. We have left-hand turn lanes in a lot of intersections in town, but we don't have four left turn lanes. A lot of our intersections are three-way. So this is the most equivalent we could get, but Main Street is actually smaller than that. If you were to keep the Common Street the way it is, this would actually end up bigger because it goes like this, and all this would be asphalt too. So it's kind of important to kind of see where that blends in. Southfield Road has a right turn lane. That's what that triangle is. So that's why it's not some glitch. There's actually a right turn lane there, and so we won't be having that.
Hi, everybody. My name is Marty Healy. I was the chair of the Main Street Working Group. Can you go back, Claire, to the one before this one? Before this. People may or may not know that, but a couple of years ago, the selectmen formed the Main Street Working Group to, our initial charge was to look at the making improvements for the TIP project. And there were seven of us, Sue Baus, Claire Reynolds, John Wilson, John Bolin, who's not here tonight. Apparently he's got a pinched nerve or something in his back, unfortunately. We hope he's there for town meeting, because for historical perspective, explaining what happened in the project, John Bolin is your man. Steve Phillips, who is out of town, and Brian Shea, who used the Main Street Working Group as a launching pad to board a selectman. So Claire's running next. Actually, it was the one after this. No, I guess it wasn't. It was the one with the pictures.
Two back?
There we go. Okay. And the reason is because this explains, you know, there was a town meeting and there were some votes taken a couple of years ago about what to do with Main Street. And there was a close vote about whether or not to form one committee. The selectmen, after that vote, formed a committee. That's us, the Main Street Design Working Group. And our charge was to look at the proposed state-funded plan, because we're looking at a plan where, you know, our Main Street, there was $6-7 million that was potentially available in state funding, as opposed to taxpayer funding to deal with issues on Main Street. But there were significant concerns about the plan. So our charge from the Board of Selectmen was take a look at this, see what, if anything, can be done to improve it, take into consideration concerns that have been raised at town meeting and before about the rural character of the town, concerns about flow of traffic, concerns about parking and where it was going to be, concerns about easements, a whole litany of concerns. And so we met, God, it's probably in the closer to 40 times now, but coming up with an initial review and proposal, we probably met 25 times or so. And the reason I put this one up to start is because it's kind of the middle of the project. We started on the west end and broke it down into segments and invited as much community comment as we possibly could get, and we got a lot of it. And we had our concerns, the selectmen had their concerns, and we heard the concerns that were raised by the community. And with the charge to make this project as good a project as we possibly could under some constraints, and there are some constraints that come with safety issues and the like for state funding. And so that was our charge. Claire, can we start with... Somebody asked about the presentation. The way it's going to work at town meeting, Karen, the Department of Public Works, will make the presentation of this is the proposed project for the town. Then, hearing from boards and committees, then we are going to weigh in on our view of why we support the project. And we've played around with various ways to present it, and we're still playing around with it. But basically what we're going to do is we are going to show, and the picture that was up there earlier showing from Deerfoot towards Parkerville is going to be sort of the model for what we're going to present, which is going to show what, we start at Sears Road, what each of the segments looks like now. So there's not what trying to remember what it looks like, but a visualization of what that looks like, and then the renderings of what we have, of what it will look like with the project, and again, we're going to try to do some photoshopping or something to add in the greenery that in the places that we can. But one of the issues that was raised, and I'll start on the west where we started in reviewing the whole project. One of the issues that was raised is we're creating a thoroughfare here. We're widening the road. We are. I'm going to create a recipe, an invitation for a speedway. Well, as you can see from this, and it continues all the way up to the Route 30, Route 85 intersection. And we went back and we looked at the numbers. And if you take, the intersection is going to be larger with the left-hand turn lanes. So taking the intersection and putting it aside. But the roadway from Sears Road to Park Street, the additional average width for that road is about a foot. That's it. It's not, there are definitely bike lanes going in. There are sidewalks going in. The road is going to be the same width. In some instances, it's going to be narrower. In some instances, a little bit wider. But the average additional width of the road from Sears Road to Park Street is a foot. That's it. It's not a thoroughfare. It's a foot wider on average for the length of the project. Again, putting the intersection aside. The going from west to east, Karen talked about it. The sidewalks all along the way will be as the highest quality that we can get within the reasonable cost. But one of the things we looked at was the aesthetics of the project as well. And so that's why our view, and I think for the most part, people who we spoke with during the course of the project in community, back and forth, agreed that if we could, where possible, where there was enough room, have the road, and then before the actual sidewalk paving begins, 12-inch or an 18-inch piece of the way it is sort of from Parkerville up towards the Faith School, so that the road, the asphalt is broken. And so everywhere along the way, where there's enough room, and there are some spots where there's not, but where there is enough room, there will be road. There will then be asphalt for bikes and for other safety considerations. Then the sidewalk curbing will begin, but the sidewalk won't begin. There will be 12 to 18 inches of greenery and then the sidewalk. And that will be, again, the entire length of the project. There are some like between Deerfoot and Parkerville, there just isn't enough room. But then when you start again up the hill, there is. And for most of the way from, for instance, from 85 going east, there's enough room. There's certainly enough room on the north side of the road where there currently is that with the trees. And there should be enough room as well on the south side of the road. So from Sears Road to Deerfoot, for the most part, not a whole lot of change in terms of what it looks like, other than it's going to look a lot better. The roadway will be improved in terms of its subsurface, the way Karen described, and the aesthetics, again, beauty's in the eye of the beholder, but at least the general feedback we've gotten, our view when we're putting together, is that the aesthetic of that road will improve greatly with the addition of the sidewalk, with the addition of the greenery. Karen didn't talk about it. One of the other big parts of the project is drainage at the Parkerville. That's a big part of the project. She talked about the fact that there are drainage issues, a big cost, and it's part of the funding that we get from the state is to improve the drainage. And there'll be, Karen, you're going to have to give me the name of what you call that that's going to be put in at Parkerville, the pod type thing. Retention ponds. I'm not the engineer up here. But at the corner of Parkerville, on the south side of Parkerville, the southwest side of Parkerville, there'll be retention put in so that the runoff is treated. Most of the time, the runoff will stop there. If it doesn't stop there, it'll be treated before it goes into the stream. So the drainage, and that's a big part of the cost of the project, that'll be improved. And again, that improves the longevity of the road, because you're not going to have the sort of drainage issues that you have wearing away at your roads. Can we go up to the common again? Okay. Karen talked about the improvements here. Now, we've had a number of different questions about the parking on Main Street. One of the few places along this entire project where there will be parking on Main Street is under the TIP project, and under the recommendation that we've made is in front of the Stone business and in front of the Morris's funeral home. But that parking won't be the way it is now, and that's what Karen was talking about in terms of the easement. The way the parking is going to be able to be done there with a sidewalk is an easement would be gotten from the homeowners that would allow the sidewalk to begin on their property. So you'd push the sidewalk back from where it would be otherwise. Otherwise, it would have to be out on the town's property. So you push the back, the sidewalks would be on the owner's property. That would be the easement. And parking then would be where the sidewalk otherwise would be. So under the state-funded project, the TIP project, those businesses get parking that if you simply just pave the road and put in sidewalks would not be available, because all of the way along Main Street now, where there are kind of sidewalks, but there was a berm originally. There wasn't really sort of normal sidewalk that you're going to get here, and it's just worn down over time. Those are going to be turned into real sidewalks. And again, you can't do a state-funded project and have the safety issues that are created by not having proper sidewalks on a main street. So all along the way from Sears up through 85. There'll be park. There'll be sidewalks all along the south side of the road, with the again normal sidewalks. Yeah, granite curbing all the way to 85, and again from 85 down to Park Street on both sides of the road with granite curbing. There'll also be some additional sidewalks on the north side, starting right near the Fay Street crosswalk, the Fay School crosswalk, that will continue up towards the common and around towards the townhouse. And again, the renderings up there are the best ones to see. If we put them up here, you really wouldn't get an idea. If you want to get an idea of exactly what it's, where the sidewalks are going to be, we're going to try to do this at town meeting, but unfortunately, with the detail, it doesn't project well. But those are available here tonight, and they'll be available at town meeting. Now, let's skip to the last, because we were talking about cost. I talked about our original charge being to look at what things would be, how we could best structure a project under the state funding. Okay. There we go. And so after the easements failed at town meeting in April, the selectmen expanded our charge to think about, look at, potentially evaluate, maybe even come up with a proposed second plan, alternative plan. And we did our best, but it was a bit of a challenge, because one of the things we found out when we were doing it originally is that in order to come up with our proposal, there was an awful lot of compromise that was needed in terms of there are a number of things in the proposed TIP project, state-funded project, that, you know, if I were king, wouldn't be in there. We compromised in terms of our view, what was best for safety, what was best for aesthetics, and the like. We tried that with an alternative project, and for the most part, people who were opposed to the state plan, whether, I don't know if it's for tactical reasons, I don't know if it's because they don't think it's their responsibility, I don't think if it's because they think they need the use of engineers, we couldn't get any traction on what people wanted in a different plan. So what we were left with, what we decided to do, rather than come up with a second plan, and which you know raised the potential of that just being shot at by people, what we decided to do is determine whatever, if the state-funded plan is not the one the town chooses at town meeting, what is the minimum that would be done to deal with Main Street, and what would the cost of that be? And there are three things that we determined would have to be in any plan that dealt with Main Street. We recommended that to the selectmen. I believe they've adopted that any plan dealing with Main Street that's not the state-funded plan would have to include at least three things. That is, number one, you have to deal with the road. And you have to deal with the road the way that Karen explained. You can't just throw a coat of paint on it, a coat of pavement. It's got bigger problems than that. So the road is going to have to be dealt with the way Karen explained. And this isn't a Karen Galligan idea. We drilled down with Karen, with the consultants that have been hired by the town, and with John Bolin, again, who's got 50, 60 years of you know, historical knowledge about the DPW and the roads in Southborough, to make sure that if you're going to deal with this road, you have to deal with it in a way that's set out earlier. You have to dig down, and it's your main street, you don't want to do it so a year from now you've got potholes, 5 years from now you've got to deal with it again. So any work on Main Street is going to have to be dealt with the way Karen explained. That's expensive. Any plan dealing with Main Street is going to have sidewalks. Now, the difference between the state-funded plan and a plan that would have to be funded by the town, and again, we went with bare minimum cost. The sidewalks for bare minimum cost wouldn't be as good as the ones under the state-funded plan. They wouldn't have be able to build in the aesthetics that we talked about in terms of the you know, the grassy areas. They would only be where there are existing sidewalks. In other words, we wouldn't get the additional sidewalks on the north side of Route 30 at about the Fay School, heading east and up towards the townhouse. It would only be where there are existing or should be existing sidewalks. So that's the second thing. First thing is you deal with the road. Second thing is you put in sidewalks. And the third thing is the drainage that we talked about. So any plan, regardless of what it is, regardless of what colors you wanted to make, crosswalks or things like that, those three things would have to be in any plan. And we've got a model for determining what the cost for that would be, because we've got a project that's already been projected for cost. We've got the state-funded project. And so all we had the engineers do was to pull the numbers out of the state-funded project and determine what those would be for those three things that we talked about. And they come to $4.7 million. Now, there have been a couple of numbers that have been tossed around, and Karen's responsible for a couple of them, giving short answers to questions. Well, the Main Street Design Working Group, our view of this thing is we've got a responsibility to the town. And if the town decides that they want to approve the state-funded project, great, that's what we recommend. But if the town decides that you don't want to go with the state-funded project, then it's our responsibility to let you know what the cost is going to be to go a different route. And so we started from the beginning. We determined what would be necessary in any non-state funded project and what the cost of that would be, and it's $4.7 million, period. Now, with the 4.7, and in a lot of respects, that makes sense, because we're talking about a $7 million project, and the $7 million project is to pave the road. And so most of the cost of that $7 million project is to pave the road. So if you're going to pave the road, it's going to cost a significant portion of that $7 million. And this reflects that. Now, with those three things, with the dealing with the road, not just the paving, but the dealing with the structural issues, with putting in sidewalks where there need to be sidewalks, putting them where there currently are and should be, and dealing with the drainage. What you don't get with a non-state funded project that you would get with the state funded project. I've already talked about the additional sidewalks. I've already talked about the additional aesthetics. The state project, for every tree that has to be taken down, and some of them are mature, some of them aren't, some of them are dying, but for every tree that's going to be taken down, at least two of them will be replaced. There'll be additional work that'll be done on the stone walls that'll be able to be done. And obviously any damage that's done during the course of construction is taken care of by the state project and the state funding. The intersection just past the library on Route 30 is improved. The size of the common is improved at the top. There's handicapped crosswalks at every stage that are improved. There's crosswalks that are higher quality. There is an improved intersection at Park Street. There is parking in front of the Morris's business and the Stone business that you wouldn't get under the simply paving the road without and not doing any easements. And that, not surprisingly, is what makes up so you wouldn't be getting approximately $2.5 million that the state would be funding for all of those other things. You wouldn't get the sidewalk that goes from, that currently is part of the state plan, that goes from Route 30 down to the Woodward School. You wouldn't get that sidewalk. You wouldn't get the improvements to the sidewalks up at the Route 30, the back sidewalk from Woodward up to Route 30. You wouldn't get the improvements there. You wouldn't get the improvements for the lighting at the public safety complex. None of that, again, you'd be missing out on $2.5 million. So there's a cost. Now, the other thing you wouldn't be getting under if you don't go with the state project is a larger intersection. And that is, I mean, I talked about the average width of the road, about a foot. The intersection with three left-hand turns under the state-funded project is larger. There's no question about it. That's and the reason it's larger is because it's dictated by two things. Number one, the state looking at environmental concerns, because without the left-hand turn lanes, you've got more of a weight in traffic, particularly at the peak hours, than you will with a left-hand turning lane. It's not dramatic. It's not, you zip through in 8 seconds as opposed to waiting in line for 5 minutes. But right now, it's probably a 35 or 40 second difference in rush hour, and projected 10 years down the line, because for better or worse, more traffic is coming to Southborough. It's not being drawn by this road, but it's being drawn by growth in the area. And as that traffic grows, if the intersection doesn't get dealt with the, and the best way to deal with it is with left-hand turns, the traffic is just going to get worse. So that's one, is from an environmental standpoint. That's the other reason the state is willing to fund the project, but also why they need the left-hand turn lanes. And the other is safety. I mean, one of the, aesthetics are important in this project, and we were very concerned with them, but the most important thing is safety. Sidewalks mean safety. Bike lanes mean safety. Improved and enhanced sidewalks mean safety. Improved and enhanced handicap crossings mean safety. The left-hand turn lanes mean safety. The reason we couldn't give more parking, even as flexible as we tried to be in front of the Stones business and the Morris's funeral home, is because of safety concerns. There are state formulas, and there's a good reason for state formulas, that you can't have parking close enough to an intersection. Anybody goes anywhere, you see those signs. You can't park more than a certain number of feet for the intersection. So for pedestrians, for bicyclists, for handicapped, and for drivers, across the board, there are improvements with the state-funded plan. The biggest cost is there's a larger intersection, and Karen has showed you. It's not as large as the intersection down at Southville and 85, but it is a larger intersection than we have now. There's no question about it, no getting around it. But with that intersection, which, again, beauty's in the eye of the beholder. Some people find it abhorrent. Our view is it's a deal. It's not that big a deal. And particularly with the benefits that it brings. So, I talked for a while.
You just need to tell people what to do.
Yes. So when we go to question and answer, I'm just going to give people instructions on how to do it.
Okay.
So if that's okay, if you're all set.
I am.
Okay. So, I'm taking a mic from you.
Okay. I didn't know where you had where I was going.
Hi guys, I'm Ryan Donovan, I'm the library director. I think I know almost everybody here. So what we're gonna do is open up the forum to public comment now, which I'm sure many of you would like to comment. We're gonna line up in the middle row, and then what's gonna happen is I'm gonna hand the mic to the first person, and then if they could hand it to the person behind them, and then everybody will sort of move up. And that's just gonna help Access Media sort of get the public commentary videotaped and recorded, if that's okay. So is that good with everybody? Yeah? I see some nods. Okay, so we're gonna do it. So if we could line up, if people have any comments, I'll be happy to hand the mic off to the first person.
I was gonna ask Marty to do this, but I was gonna ask Marty to do this, but just emphasize again two things. One is that the road project itself at town meeting is basically not amendable. And we're there to vote, and Karen mentioned it, but we're voting on the easements, and it takes a two-thirds vote. And that's what town meeting is about. It's
yeah, but that's a very good point.
And that if somebody has to make a statement about why they don't want the project, that's great, but it's the easements that the state requires that either makes it work or doesn't.
Yeah, two things, and I'll try to make this quick, so because we want to hear from people, we want to hear questions. Hopefully, we can answer some of them. When it's a state-funded project, you live with the state rules. One of the state rules is with respect to easements. Easements are a taking an interest in property. The interest in property, it could be in the air, it could be for a sidewalk, but it's a taking of property. And for the taking of property, there are three ways for a governmental entity to get property. So somebody who owns the property or property interest can give it to them. It can be sold at an agreed upon after an appraisal price, or it can be taken through eminent domain. the with a state-funded project, you can't even talk to a landowner about a potential price for an easement they might be given until the town's ability to get the easements is approved. It's not our rule, it's the state's rule. So as a result, we haven't had the opportunity. Some of you might be, landowners here who are going to be affected by easements, and you're wondering, well, why aren't we talking about, what my compensation is going to be for this temporary or permanent easement? Because the town can't do it. It's handcuffs that the state puts on. I'm sure there's good reasons for it. I don't know what they are, but so that's why that hasn't happened. The second thing is the way the project works. We're on a lot of towns in the state want money, so they don't have to raise their taxes, and so there are battles to get on these lists, and there are priorities to get on the list. We're in a good position to get on a list to start construction next year.
No. So fiscal 18 for work for them. So it bids next year, and then construction starts in 18 spring.
Okay, but fiscal year 18.
Yes, construction in 17.
Okay, but the way it works is there are various stages along the way. They call them a 25% stage, a 75% stage, and at each of those stages, the town submits where it is in its process for its proposal for what it's going to do, given the work that needs to be done and the requirements that the state imposes on you. That's done at a 25% stage, a 75% stage. And then the state gets that and then reviews it and determine whether or not it's a project they're going to fund, whether or not it meets their requirements, whether or not it's going to deal with the environmental reasons for being able to fund the project and for the safety reasons to fund the project. Once that is done, John's point about town meeting, we can't amend the project on the floor and say, you know what, I'd rather have 5 parking spaces here than 4, so I move to amend that project and people vote on it. It's like all of a sudden the project's amended and we vote on that. We're voting on the easements, but in deciding whether or not to give the town authorization, it's a 2/3 vote, to start negotiating with landowners about the easements, it's an up or down vote. It's not like we can go back into the project, amend what's already been done. We like to think that the work we put in on this for the state project, we did about as well as you can possibly do in terms of taking into consideration the town's character, not changing the road, not dramatically changing the way downtown Southborough, Main Street Southborough is going to look, and in fact improving an awful lot of the aesthetics and safety along the way. We didn't do a perfect job, but we think we did a pretty darn good job on getting the best possible project for people to consider, and again, in terms of our recommendation, to hopefully vote for.
I'm going to start with questions. So on the easements, if this gets voted yes at town meeting, and the selectmen will then be able to approach for all these people, what will happen if people say, I don't want it, and not negotiate with the selectmen? And how does that affect this? And you use the term eminent domain. And if 2/3 of the people say that they'll do it and negotiate and 1/3 doesn't, if it's approved at town meeting by the 2/3 vote, are we guaranteed that this TIP project can go on?
Yeah. Okay. So that's a tough question. I have the answer and no one's going to like it. What does happen is that, and first let me just point out that there's only probably like 30 property owners actually in reality, because you've got Faith School and you've got St. Mark's, you have the town. So there's actually not a lot, there's a few businesses and a few homeowners really affected by this. We have talked to, out of the 30 property owners, 26 of them. So we've made good headway. There's just a few kind of LLCs that I was having trouble finding a phone number for and finding a person to talk to. But if we can't do the negotiation, if someone just absolutely doesn't want to negotiate, unfortunately, that is why the town meeting does vote the eminent domain piece. And the project would still go forward. the people would still get paid the amount of the appraisal that we have to do in order to make sure it's a fair appraisal and a review appraisal. They still get that amount, and then they obviously have the opportunity to protest that, but it doesn't stop the project, so the project does continue.
And the one thing, Karen, and correct me if I'm wrong, but oh. Again, I explain the handcuffs that the state puts on you in terms of negotiating with landowners. But you can talk with them, and that's why Karen says that there's been discussion. And, you know, knock on wood and never say never, but there has not been an overwhelming negative reaction to the idea. I mean, Karen showed them. Most of the easements are modest. And the ones that aren't modest, the good news is many of them affect nonprofits or governmental institutions or impact businesses that are going to benefit from the easements. So, you know, the prospect of eminent domain sits there. There's no question about it for the easements. Doesn't mean we're taking somebody's property, but you are taking a property interest that they have with an easement. And those are all laid out in terms of what the square footage is for the property owners that have been affected. But from the conversations that have been communicated to us that the town has had with folks, there has not been an overwhelming negative response to the idea of these easements. So I hope I'm not overstating what the reaction was. I don't think I am based on what we've heard.
And, you know, going to John Wilson's point, I think it's going to be very important that the whole subject of the easements, even the fact that you've talked to 26 of the 30 entities where the easements would be affected, that you bring that up, and even giving an example of how small, you know, the easement was. And I think maybe in the town warrant it might have detailed out but you know, yeah. So I think if we really make that very clear, I also think that this presentation versus last year, where you didn't have the visuals, I think is just so much more impactful. And I think the most difficult thing is last year, if 26 out of 30 is a good measure, are not negative about this, we've got just a few naysayers. And to not be able to take advantage of $7+ million of state money versus the alternative of 4.7 of our money and raise taxes, I think everything that you've done tonight and really focusing on the easements and that's what it's all about should make a difference, because there will still be, you know, the same naysayers that get up and, you know, have their concerns. But I think most importantly what I've learned tonight is that, you know, as far as Morris and Stone are concerned, you know, you go with the alternative plan and there is no parking at all, because you can't move the stone wall. So I think this presentation, you know, in whatever form you tweak it, I would hope would be very effective next Tuesday.
John Rooney, Edgewood Road. One question that keeps coming up when I talk to people is this perceived price fluctuation in the local option, the so-called local option. And I think it'll be important to explain at town meeting how the price got to where it was from where it was perhaps a year ago. And I believe the most recent suggestion is that the selectmen are in support of this article, so they are trying to inflate the local option to get residents to vote in favor of the state option. But I think it will be important, and maybe this is the place to begin the discussion as to where the original price came from, where the second number came from, and then I think, Marty, you explained completely where the final number came from. But I do think it makes sense to have that discussion as well.
Yeah, I can definitely address that. This is my favorite thing to talk about. You hear a number for $925,000. It's just a bad number. It's wrong. I did give it to somebody who asked me for it through an email, and I included all this stuff, and the truth is that I can't replicate that. I haven't been able to make it happen again. It was a mistake. It's a bad number, and it really just needs to be ignored. It's a little bit crazy as a number. It was a reclaim, which I showed what the reclaim is, so we're not even physically capable of doing what I thought we would be doing, but even doing it that way, the numbers aren't right. It just doesn't work out. Looking at the second number that came up, which is a $2.5 million, $2.25 million, that was still also a reclaim project. So that's why it again, that was like a 12-inch reclaim. So that's why it was more expensive, because our standard is a 6-inch, which would have been what I was thinking of originally. So it was a 12-inch, but the problem with that, again, is that you can't do the road that way. We're pulling away all the good material in a lot of places if we do that. It needs to be a full reconstruction. It also, if you kind of look at what we put into the slide of what's involved in the project, if it's outside, there's a contingency number, there's oversight and engineering, because there's grading that has to be done, so we actually need stakes out there, we need somebody out there doing that work. The DPW, we don't have the staff, we don't have the expertise to actually do all the surveying required. So there's a lot of other pieces that go into that number that made it the 4.7. The 2.25 really didn't include that, but it also was only a reclaim. And so that's a significant change. Hopefully that answers it.
Claire Reynolds, I'm also on the Main Street group. I just want to make sure that everybody realizes that if you're in support of this, please get all of your friends who are also in support of it, because the problem is that if this fails at town meeting, this is the last shot. Essentially, we don't get to bring it up anymore. The DOT said, that's it.
Yeah, that planning strike organization one, strike gave two, us two strikes, out. Not three.
Okay.
I just wanted to say that when you had that presentation with the two, you know, pictures of the ground and what it was going to look like, the two drawings.
Yes.
I would say when you put those up, that's when you say what you just said about what you've previously said, because I think that sort of signifies for people like me that don't know all of this, that says to me that this is what we've got, this is what we used to do, this, and this is why it was, you know. I mean, you're going to have to just eat crow about the 975, but as far as the 2.5 is concerned, at least there was it wasn't something that you didn't think about. I think it was.
Thank you. Nobody? No one else? Oh, we got one.
Vincent Valvo on Latisquamma Road. Vincent Valvo, Latisquamma Road. My question is, who pays for the easements, if they are paid, if the town approves? And second of all, what is the, you must have done some sort of fair market value of the square footage that's in there, what that cost might be?
So we, as far as the easements go, we haven't done the appraisal yet, but kind of as a quick check, because of how limited the square footage is, we're thinking, we're talking, because a lot of them are coming from Fay and St. Mark's and us and, you know, the government, we're probably talking in the $35,000 range. However, that is funded, we can pay for that through our Chapter 90 funds. So that's all reimbursed through the state, and it's actually not going to have to come out of our pocket.
One more question, and that is, you'd mentioned the width being, on average, maybe an extra foot. Mm-hmm. Okay, where is the widest area, and what is that width at that point?
So It's a very consistent road width, which we don't have now, and that's why it kind of changes. So it's two 11-foot travel lanes, which is what we have, and then there's 4-foot shoulders. So currently, if you go out there, there's two 11-foot travel lanes. So if you go to that side of 85, the other side, the east, you're going to see that you already have it, and you have two 4-foot shoulders, and you have sidewalks on both sides. There's not a lot of change. It actually squeezes a little, and then it squeezes quite a bit over at Park Street. At the down it, when you get to Sears Road, you'll see that there's not a lot of shoulder there. So that's where you might have a foot on either side of your fog line, right? So you have the two level, and you don't really have a shoulder. That's where you'd probably notice it the most. But it's because we stay at 2 11-foot, so it's, and then two 4-foots. So you end up with a 30-foot cross section of the road throughout the corridor, except where the parking is at in front of Stones and Morris's. And when you get to there, then you have a parking spot, so you actually have an extra 4 feet.
Okay, you're saying the widest is 4 feet?
The widest change? I'm sorry, I thought you meant where the widest, I'm sorry. There's probably down by Sears Road, there's probably a spot where it's a few feet on one side and up to a few on the other. So you might be talking 6 to 7 feet in some spots.
That's a good question, though. We should break it down so we can explain that to people. That's a good question.
People might be scared of where that is.
Yep. No, that's a very good question.
I can't resist. Thanks. I'm Sam Stivers, 7 Presidential Drive, a member of the Advisory Committee, but speaking as a private citizen. I'm one of the, quote, naysayers, I guess, here, in that I have co-sponsored an alternate Warren Article number 5 that basically says let's repave without doing the state-level requirements on the repavement and try to find a way to do it on a lower impact basis. And this Warren article actually was produced shortly after town meeting last year before any of this additional work was done, so we didn't have the ability to analyze as much of the recent work. But I think the thought was that those of us who sponsored this alternate article were concerned about the look and feel and the impact of the project on the look and feel of town. And one of the reasons that some of us moved here was that it had some sort of a more small town look and feel, which was appealing to us. And I personally think that's something that's worth preserving. I think this project would change it. I look at other places like Northborough and Hudson where similar projects have happened. That's not a look I like. And so one of it is aesthetic. And I know Marty has been frustrated because I can't quantify aesthetic.
I never get frustrated.
Well, I'm feeling some frustration at least. But that is a tough one. And it's hard to put that in specific terms. The other side is that I'm sort of a numbers person. And I've been troubled by the changing numbers through this process, as Karen has suggested. And I guess one of the things that some of us believe is that there is actually a lower cost, lower impact alternative here. And that for something like $2.5 million, which actually is money that we have or will have through the normal funding process over the next several years through the state funding, local funding for highways, we could actually afford $2.25 million without impact on the property tax rates. And so that's what we would prefer to explore, and we'll actually have more detail. I'm not here tonight to debate the merits of the easement issue or whatever, but we believe that the $4.7 million project, as described here, is something of a red herring. We'll talk about that a little more later as well. So again, simply stated, we like the look and feel. We're not excited about the prospect of creating a draw for cut-through traffic potentially. And we think there is another lower impact option that would be feasible if, in fact, this vote fails on Article 4. Thanks.
1 second, Sam. Just to be clear, so you wouldn't, the what you're proposing doesn't include the intersection, new sidewalks or anything, right?
It doesn't include the intersection. Sidewalks, I think we're certainly in favor of sidewalks generally, but how much can you do and should you do with sidewalks? We don't have an alternate plan. We don't have engineering money to put together an alternate plan. But, we're certainly, again, interested in safety, interested in sidewalks. Speaking of the intersection, by the way, I've been surprised that the impact of spending $2.5 million bucks or something on the intersection there is a surprisingly small amount of additional traffic capacity and surprisingly small cut in the wait time to get through the intersection. I think it was like 8 seconds or something like that, as I recall from the traffic study. So, you know, again, that's spending a lot of money. And frankly, again, I think that it's easy to get sort of blinded by the lure of $7 million in state money, but my experience over many years is that there's no such thing as a free lunch, and that you got to be careful in terms of grabbing for those kinds of things, because often there are surprises with them. So, thank you.
Since this is a forum, I just wanted to ask Sam a few questions with regards to this, because I think it would be important for town special town meeting members to know this two point whatever million dollar less costly option. Does it involve fixing the structure of the road, which is required not just by Karen's analysis, the Main Street Committee's analysis, the expert consultant's analysis, but also the state's analysis? Does it involve fixing the structure of the road, essentially rebuilding the road? I think town meeting members would also like to know, will there be sidewalks with this lower cost plan? And also, what would be done about the drainage problems? So, and one of the things I've asked consistently since the last town meeting is that I think it really only benefits the people at town meeting to know what the cost options are. So rather than just throwing out a number that we believe that this can be done for approximately $2.5 million, I think it would be important to put a little bit of meat on those bones to figure out what do you get for that, and give us the analysis. Because what I have heard, and I assume what the majority or what everyone at town meeting will hear, is this is the cost of the road based upon what it needs to be done pursuant to the rules and regulations. So if there's another number, Sam, I think it would be helpful to understand how you came up with that number.
Yeah, I'm not an engineer. I don't have an engineering plan, John.
Good evening. I'm Dan O'Rourke, and I've lived in Southborough now 16 years. I use this intersection all the time. I run through here, I bike through here. There's kids that bike through here, the kids from Fay, they walk from here over to Morrow's, whatever. It's definitely not safe. And I hate to break it to you, but Southborough is a cut-through town. It absolutely is. We have 85, we have Route 30, Route 9. People fly up and down Sears Road. People fly up and down Middle Road, Parkerville Road, all these streets. We're a cut-through town. Is there an expiration to this funding, to the Chapter 90 funding? Did you mention that?
So the Chapter 90 funding does not expire. The TIP funding, so the $7.2 million, if we don't get the vote at town meeting, they have a lot of competition for the money, so they'll move it on to another project. Okay. So this is our last chance.
And let me weigh in as well. Because Sam mentioned there are no free lunches, and there aren't here. Basically, there are three ways to pay for the road, doing work on the road. Number one is the one we've talked about the most tonight, and that is getting the funding from the state. The second way to do it, Sam Stivers alluded to it, was to not raise taxes, but to use Chapter 90 money. And basically, Chapter 90 money is every year the state allows a town, and they match some percentage of it on an annual basis, to put aside money for road work. And the idea would be to not raise taxes to pay for the Main Street project. We get, what is it, $600,000-$700,000 a year we can put into?
$450,000 and then $250,000 from the town.
Okay, so $700,000. $450,000 from the state, $250,000 of our own money that goes into Chapter 90 money. So if you had, for instance, a $2.5 million project, that'd be 3.5 years of Chapter 90 money. And that Chapter 90 money is there regardless. It's baked into the tax rate. So yeah, using that Chapter 90 money would not raise the town's taxes. But again, there are no free lunches. What that would mean is for 3.5 years, no other roads in town would get done.
Okay, so
because all the money would be soaked up by that.
One more question.
And the third way is just to raise taxes.
Which we don't want to do. So out front here from the intersection to Middle Road, is that right now on the south side of Route 30, is that technically a sidewalk? Okay. So then the cars that are parking there now aren't supposed to be parking there.
Correct.
Correct. Correct. Okay.
Just one other thing, too, is the whole safety. By the way, I live on Main Street, but the state paved my side of Main Street. So I really don't have a dog in this fight. However, as was pointed out, the state did a reclaim.
The state planed off an inch and put an inch of overlay on.
Did less than a reclaim then?
Yes.
Okay. So it's already starting to crack, which I've learned since I've been on this committee to be able to identify those things. I think that the big safety aspect is the whole thing. You have the sidewalks where people are currently parking. And if you walk up Main Street from Parkerville Road and you go up towards Faith School, you have a semi-sidewalk, which at least has the grass buffer. Then you move on to where, in front of Faith School, you have the sidewalks with a concrete, with a granite curb. And as you keep walking, then all of a sudden you bump into a car. And that's because the car is parked on the sidewalk. The people in town here have said, from one of the studies of the Public Works Group, said that they want sidewalks. It is in a school zone. Also, too, for those of you who live west of, say, Parkerville Road, everybody walks in front of 84 Main Street, the Garfield House. There is no sidewalk there. You're kind of taking your life in your hands, so this would add a sidewalk onto that whole part. So the big thing is really the safety aspect of it that needs to be looked at. I was the person who actually was behind the car that stopped at heading west and stopped at Middle Road to take a left-hand turn. And out of the blue, because you were facing west and there were cars parked along Main Street, I was the person who witnessed the guy who got hit on the bicycle and was really very, very badly hurt, because there was no way that the driver could see the bicyclist coming between the cars. If you had a bicycle lane, you would not have that kind of situation. So this is one of the things, as traffic gets increased through town, which is going to happen, this is one of the things. So every single bit of safety measurements that can be taken to do this project correctly should definitely be done. And if we get it paid for, why not? So again, I can't reiterate, the important thing is to get your friends who are in support of this to come out at town meeting. It's Article 4, so it will be early in the evening for those who want to plan something else later on, I guess, after town meeting. And that's my piece.
And thank even you. If you're not in support of it, still come to town meeting and we'll try to convince you there. So, yeah.
Sorry. It's okay. So I'm back. I'm still Vincent Velvo on Latisquamba Road. So let me just make sure, if the easements are not approved, then the only plan that we know about that has any viable and somewhat analyzed data is the one that was 4.7.
Yes.
Okay. There's no other plan that we know of that has been looked at, or there is any documentation. There's nothing available to look at. It would be if the easements are not approved, we're likely then to move to a $4.7 plan. Is that correct?
Yeah, and I'll take one step further. We have, not out of frustration, but out of trying to get information, we have pleaded with folks who are not in support of this plan to give us information about what plan they would want instead, and That's why we ended up doing this.
Right. Okay.
So we couldn't get that.
So let me just my own opinion is that if we don't have any documentation or a process, then there's no plan. I mean, this is it. This is all that I can vote on is something that has been up there. There's an Excel spreadsheet, talks about how much the cost is going to be, you know, all the other items involved. If we don't have anything else than that, then there is no other plan. Am I right about that?
Yes.
My answer to that is yes. I suspect some people may disagree, but I agree with you.
Can I ask who's presenting at October 18th?
The town meeting?
Yeah.
It's you, right?
Yes.
Karen is going to, the order I described earlier is Karen is the town representative who will describe, and a lot of it will be what was captured here, and then the Main Street group as a town board and committee will make its recommendation. And that'll be it'll probably be longer than hers.
If anyone has any suggestions, good or bad, or criticisms, please just call me at the DPW. I'm there a lot. But you can also email me and get me on the website, because I'd be great. I mean, I'd love to make it more succinct if possible. But on the other hand, it just seems like there's a lot of information that you're trying to get out, because a lot of people, I mean, I appreciate everybody coming here and attending. Kids, it's a pain, and I know it's hard to get to things. So I really appreciate it, but a lot of people can't make it, but do make it to town meeting, and so I need to try to get that information out. So anybody has any good suggestions or ideas, and I appreciate everyone who did say some stuff tonight to me. I took notes, so hopefully I can get that in there correctly.
Do you have any other suggestion about if one is in favor of, I probably don't need it.
If one is in favor of the TIP plan, any suggestion about how we can drum up interest? I mean, you talk about, asking your friends and neighbors, and of course, that's the key. You know, if the people who are against it, form their group and come out, but the people who are for it don't, then, we're rather sunk. So,
it's 2/3 is a very high bar.
Yeah.
And we actually have been told that the reason a few people have just kind of waited for that was because they knew it's a high bar, and they said, well, that can kill the project. So it's very difficult to get that. I mean, this is about the biggest forum I've had, so I really, Heritage Day and the transfer station, I mean, I've got people, but again, it's getting them to the meeting. I don't know if the pamphlets might help at all, if people have kind of an email list and they take nuggets out of that they think are good and try to send them out to people and tell them to come. But again, I can't really promote, I mean, I'm trying to give out good information to the project. Actually, this guy can promote it. I really just have to tell you that the facts, and whichever way the town votes, I want to make sure it's a good project. I want to make sure we fix Main Street. So if it doesn't get done by the TIP project, that's why we really wanted to be very clear of what it would be, because I don't want to spend the town's money doing something that's just going to get wrecked soon. I want to be very fiscally responsible. We try really hard down at DPW to do as much as we can with what we have rather than make extra. Mm-hmm. But I don't know if any you guys have any promotions that you can do.
I mean, my Southborough has been doing a very good job,
yeah.
Promoting it. We've tried when we're before the Historical Commissioner Advisory to get local media to cover it. That's been sort of a mixed bag.
Yes.
With the Metro West News. I'd like to think there's going to be something in the newspaper this week. You'd like to think about the upcoming meeting. The Red Sox losing probably helps.
But even if, I guess you have flyers now, and by the way, I'm Carol Long, 3 Crestview Drive, and I grew up in Southborough. My mother's family has been here for 11 generations. Not that I personally remember when it was a dirt road, I don't, but I do remember when it was a very small town, and to me, 10,000 people is actually big enough to warrant a bigger Main Street for safety. But if there's, you know, maybe the flyers. Who's generating those, Karen?
I made them. So
you made them.
I actually don't think I've put them up on the website yet, so I actually can do that. I'll make a note of that. But I'm going to, Ryan will probably let me keep some here at the library. And there's some at the senior center, and I've got to put some at the town hall. But again, not that many people visit us, you know, at the town buildings if they don't have to. So the website might be the best spot.
Okay.
Could you have them put on my Southborough's attachments?
You know what? I'm sure Beth would put them out if we asked her.
People click on and see them. Rally people at the transfer station.
Oh, sure, go ahead.
I will be there.
Hi, I'm Kristen Laval. I also grew up in Southborough. I moved my family back here because I love the small town feel as well. I just want to say I've been trying to rally other parents. People just don't know about town meeting. It's not the project. They don't know about town meeting. They didn't know that about showing up and that we actually raised our hand to vote. I mean, they don't, if you're not from this area, they don't appreciate it. So that's, we got to educate on that. We have a Facebook page, Southborough for Main Street. Get out there, like it, spread it out there, use social media. And that's my recommendation.
I also wanted to say, especially if Karen has some flyers, walk up and down your street, hand them out, knock on doors. All the Democrats will be up in New Hampshire, so we won't be in your way.
What for?
Hi, Bill Boland, 35 East Main Street. The only thing I'll say is there's talk about other options. There are other options. We could do a 1-inch reclaim and lay down 1 inch like further down on Main Street like the state did. But there's only one other option to do the project right. So if we want to do it now and do it again in 2 years or 3 years, there are other options. But if we really want to rebuild the road the right way, the only other option is that $4 million option.
Are you getting the hook? No. I have a couple announcements. If everyone has gotten a chance to speak, yes? Anyone else? I don't want to take the mic away from anyone. So until next Tuesday, we have been displaying for the last month. Karen and I worked together to get a full sort of design of Main Street in the back of the library. So you'll be able to come and review the plans up until next Tuesday. Following town meeting, whichever way it goes, we'll be bringing them down. And then if you wouldn't mind, if you guys, thank you all for coming. I think Karen and Marty deserve a round of applause, as do you. Thank you for caring and coming to this. If you like programs like this, we have a new community survey from the library. So we just, if you wouldn't mind taking one or take a few minutes, it's also online. So you guys can take it that way, if you prefer. But just come see me or Richard Wallace, who's the trustee chair of the library. We'll be handing out surveys to anybody who'd like to take one. Thank you.
Thank you for coming, everybody.